Good afternoon. I see some known faces, so I already apologize for the jokes I may be recycling in my speech here. I was asked to give a bit of a visionary statements on hardware evolution in smart grids, and also I added it, smart grids in smart cities, because I think for the moment that is where the interesting game is going on. And I heard you already had a talk on smart meters, and before that I saw Cedric de Jonge, who also works with us, giving a talk on business models. Well, I'm going to point at some trends that are happening in the hardware, in the technology itself. But why the smart cities? Because these days everything is smart, usually except for your car, because you find that too small or smart. But the smart cities, we hope they will be here. All these red dots indicate a city that already has several millions of inhabitants now or in the near future. All of these people are enormous consumers of electricity or other forms of energy. So, and let's be honest, they're usually located in a place where you cannot get that energy easily out of the air or out of the ground or wherever. So we have to connect the generators with the consumers, and for that we need a grid. Now, what is exactly such a smart city? Well, we may define it as a city with a smart grid. That's usually where we stop. Already enough work for us. But we also need some smart people, who know how to operate all this technology. Do you find that only in university town? Well, we hope not, because everybody should be able to do that. Already told you my car joke. But it's a bit more complicated in total. Yeah. Now, there is, of course, an official definition of a smart city. Smart cities, that's where you combine diverse technology to reduce the environmental impact and offer the citizens a better life. Way too complicated. So simply, it's a technical challenge. Yes, so engineers are going to have a lot of fun with that. But there's also an organizational change required in governments and society at large, so that everybody can have a benefit from it. So it's a multidisciplinary challenge. Official statement, so that where everybody will come together, be innovative and make it work. That's a short version of this official definition of smart cities. But in brief, you will need smart people living in smart houses, hopefully energy efficient houses, so that the environment becomes smart, sustainable, clean and so on. That also means people are not going to stay in those houses. You also need to move around, mobility. I have to say, I came from Eindhoven this morning and I had my share of stupid mobility already, especially the last 5 miles to get here was the hardest of the day already. But in the end, we're here to generate benefits for the economy. But keep in mind, all of these things, they interact with each other. Yeah? We are talking here of energy, and that's the, there's a pointer here, that's the right corner here. Energy, you may link it to other vectors, water, gas, heating, and so on. Transportation is a big consumer of energy within a smart city, the buildings as well, and they have an impact on the environment. But watch out, this side, that's more the soft side, the social side, and it's clearly interacting with all of these things. So how do we make these things work together with a toy chest full of brand new technologies all together? Well, there are four key trends, technological key trends in smart cities happening. Well, first of all, we've got these smart grids that come in. But as I said, these days, everything is smart. So perhaps we should better talk about wise grids, because that sounds a bit smarter. But these wise grids, what will they do? Well, hopefully they will bring these forms of energy that are found outside these cities, and some a little bit inside the cities, but usually that's not enough, all the way to the consumer. But these consumers themselves, they here, living here or in smaller areas, more distributed urban zone or semi-urban zones here, they also can generate a bit of energy themselves. Think of the famous solar panels on the roof, maybe a little turbine here and there. Maybe you have a little bit of bio waste that can be fermented on a farm, and so on. So actually, the distinction between what is the generator and what is the consumer is totally going away. Yeah. So we are not talking anymore of consumers, generators, but rather of prosumers, with the pro from producers. And now we have a new technology coming around the corner. We'll talk about that in a few slides. There's also a lot of storage available, and the prices are rapidly going down there. And we still have to find an acronym to get the STO into that word as well. So probably the proto-sumer or whatever. But that sound doesn't sound very good. Okay, so that's the smart grids. Now the smart grids are not only happening on the large level, not only on the large geographical levels. Also within the smaller energy units, being houses, buildings, small residential areas, there's a big revolution going on, but it's more silent than all these big wind turbines and high voltage lines that against which there is a lot of protest in practice. Well, inside the houses, we are going more and more to what we call microgrids. There's more autonomy being introduced by all these new technologies. Because if you have your own generation on your roof and you've got some smart loads that you may be control and you got a little bit of storage there, you may wonder in the end, do I really need a grid connection? Yeah, probably you need, because you want to have the same reliability as before. But does it really need to be such a powerful one as in the past? Does it have to deliver you the same kind of availability all the time? Well, you see, autonomy is getting distributed somehow as well. And then we start talking of microgrids. And you see here already suggest that we may have to leave the AC, the traditional AC power as was introduced by Tesla about a century ago. We have to maybe go back to Edison's DC, because all of these technologies in here are basically DC technologies. Who still needs 50 hertz if you're just connecting batteries and solar powers and controllable loads in the end? That's a question we have to ask ourselves. But don't forget, within these houses, everything is not electrical. Or not everything is electrical, I should say. Of course, I hope one day that everything will be electrical. I'm an electrical engineer. But unfortunately, we still need a bit of heating and hot water and so on. Now, luckily, you can also make that with electricity, with heat pumps and so on these days. And it becomes even an interesting form of controllable loads and storage. But you can go further. I'm joking a little bit about it, but my thermal colleagues are also very innovative. You can get, you can make exchanges with the underground, come up with innovative types of thermal storage as well. So it's not only about the electricity. We have our inside system, and you have to interface in a smart way with that outside system. And I almost forgot it. Here is actually technology number 4. Does this. The sustainable mobility. I have to admit, I didn't come here today with an electric car. Coming from Eindhoven to here is just a little bit too far for an electrical car, especially as I want to get back. But I came with a hybrid car, but that's just a transition technology towards more cars like this. Electrical cars, yeah, they're coming into our mobility system silently. Yes, because they don't make noise. But you see them all around. On the way to here, from Eindhoven to Brussels, I counted 4 Teslas. Yeah, most of them passed me because they drove faster than me. So in Brussels here, I spotted 3 Nissan Leafs. Yeah, and I only did a short stretch in Brussels. It's coming slowly. But it's not only these private fancy cars that are getting replaced. We should not underestimate the revolution that is happening in public transport. All those stinking diesel buses are rapidly disappearing from the cities as well. They are becoming CNG buses, hybrid buses, and in some places, the trolley bus or the modern type of it is getting reintroduced. And this is actually a modern type of trolley bus, but without wires. So it's actually a trolley bus without trolley. It has a rapid recharging unit so that whenever it makes a stop, it can very quickly and automatically plug in, recharge the batteries enough to drive until a series of next stops. So these things are being tested in several European countries and in the US and Asia. So these are in total the 4 key technologies for that are all linked up by that smart grid. Already said, bring this all together, the distinction between who's actually producing and who's consuming and at what time they are doing that is totally fading out. Yeah? We are all becoming an active party in this grid. So all these interfaces that you have to the grid, almost by definition, they have to become bi-directional. And there should be somehow some kind of control layer over it. Now, we should not just dump all this technology on the grid, because then, you see, if you do an unsmart operation of all this technology, you come to the current situation. We have done a bad thing by rapidly deploying just standard, if I may call it so, stupid photovoltaic systems. Not that I find the solar technology stupid, but the way it's connected is not very smart. They're all, most of them are single phase units randomly connected into the grid, yeah, into the single phase that where your house is connected upon. And yeah, this may sound a good thing, but in practice, most houses on the same sunny side of the street are all connected on the same phase. So you're always injecting your electricity in the same phase, and you blow up the voltages very rapidly into your feeders. And then they all switch off, and then everybody's unhappy because the photovoltaic units stop and you don't get a payout anymore from your green certificates. So we should do this in a bit more smarter way. And if we take one step further, we should, for instance, think about new kinds of interconnections, interfaces, where we do an internal balancing of the phases. So a little bit more expensive, more smarter grid interface, but it will pay back in the end, because you can use your electricity grid, you can use that asset up to its maximum capacity that way, and it's this, or they will dig open your street, that's a nuisance for 1 week, to put in a new cable, but then for the rest of the coming decades you will be paying for that cable, and that's maybe even more annoying. So with these smarter interfaces we can get a long way. And then there's this famous storage. Now we are busy already with storage, mainly in the form of batteries the past years, already for quite a long time, because it's a very interesting technology. Thanks to storage you've all got a smartphone in your pocket these days. Thanks to storage, I was able to make my way here in a quite sustainable way, because I came with a hybrid today. But the next step for storage is to come into the houses. Yeah? Because these days, we have an excess of electricity production most of the time in the middle of the day right now. Look at the weather outside. It's nice and pretty. Temperature is not that high, so we have an enormous peak of PV generation. But unfortunately, the places where that PV is generated, there's hardly any consumption now, because everybody who lives there is now standing in a traffic jam here around the corner. So there's no consumption. So we should do something about that mismatch, because the grid cannot handle all that excessive power anymore. And one of the key technologies is storage, or you can trigger certain kinds of consumption. The controllable loads is an alternative, but storage gets a lot of attention these days. And why is that? Well, here, this is a Tesla. Doesn't look that pretty, if you look at it these ways, but this is in essence of a Tesla. A Tesla is a skateboard full of batteries with a small electric motor in between. And then they put a fancily designed bodywork on top, and then you pay 75,000 euros. But if you just take these batteries and put them in an ugly box like this, Tesla sells them to you in the coming months for between $5,000 and $10,000. That's what they say. Yeah, that's what happens if you don't have to put a fancy logo and leather interior in there. But so these technologies, the prices are being dumped rapidly. When Tesla made its first Roadster, the batteries were at between $700 and $800 per kilowatt hour. Currently, they're between $200 and $300. They will open up their new gigafactory, and there are some other factories for lithium cells being built for the moment. And when they're all operational by 2020, everybody expects that the prices will be at $100 per kilowatt hour, and then it becomes really interesting. Then we can start implementing this, but we have to think of a good business model to convince people to put that next to their PV unit. Because why the hell would you do that now? Yeah, you dump your power into the grid during the day, and you've got a bit of net metering, but that's not a big deal. Huh? You can play a little bit with the difference in price between day and night. Let's say that's a factor of two. But with that, you can wait for 20 years or so to get a payback for just that investment of batteries. Yeah? And why is that? Well, the day-night price difference is honestly something, it's a relic of the 1970s when we had nuclear power that needed to be dumped in the middle of the night. So these days, we have to dump power in the middle of the day. So actually, the day-night tariff is counterinteractive against more introduction of renewables, actually, because it stops us from introducing these balancing technologies. So if we have a good business model, if we have a bit more smarter control, could be with a smart meter, but definitely you need a smart control platform on top of these systems, then you can start thinking of peak shaving and supporting the grid that way, balancing over several hours. Then you can rethink what actually is a good feed-in tariff. Or you can even, and that's interesting, when the next winter comes and all the stories of a frightening blackout or will be back there again, well, then it can also be used to enhance the security of supply. And for each of these, you can think of a certain business model. Now, the challenge is try to implement this all with a single set of storage technologies with multiple users on the same asset. That is that's high tech. Now, that brings us to new operational models. And you already had a nice example from Cédric de Jonge an hour ago, more or less. He talked about how distributed assets, distributed technologies can be used to offer ancillary services, can be used to offer reserve power. So yes, the small consumers, if I may call them so, are also making money in that complicated electricity market these days. Well, we can go much, much further with that. If you look at these famous ancillary services, these grid support services, if you look at the official definition, there are about 26 different grid services that you can officially put on a market. That's just the NTSOE definition. Not that all of them make sense to be put on a free market, but there's definitely more than just reserves that you can get money for. You can get money for that peak shaving, you get money for voltage support, for balancing, and so forth. So, to implement that, we need to come to a more distributed control, more intelligence spread out over the whole electricity grid. So you will need some agent technologies that will control all these distributed energy resources, including the storage, where it is on the level that it is necessary. This is maybe a bit of an abstract implementation, but if you it's the same as with those smart interfaces to the grid. This is just the next step, is when you're going to coordinate all those smart assets over wider areas. And then you can come up with new markets and also new ways to make money to pay for all these investments that you have to do in the smart grid. And then the grid itself. Are we going to keep it like it is now? Well, maybe you all heard of the War of the Currents about a century ago, when Tesla and Edison were fighting a dirty war over whether it should be AC or DC voltage. Yeah. Actually, it was Westinghouse who wanted AC, but he had Tesla. He hired Tesla as an inventor. Edison had lots of patents on DC technology. Actually, Edison didn't invent a lot. He just bought the inventions from others. But don't tell that when there are Americans in the room, because they think he's a national hero. But so why did Edison lose in the end? Well, there was no equivalent for a DC transformer to beef up the power to a level that you can transport it over a long distance. That was easily done with an AC transformer. That's why we were stuck with AC with a fixed frequency for one century exactly. Should it stay like this? Well, photovoltaic arrays, they give you a floating DC voltage that varies with the sunshine. Fuel cells, batteries, a more or less fixed voltage, quite low, so you have to bring it up or use big serialized stacks. Wind turbines, they have controlled drives, usually with a fixed DC voltage bus somewhere in the middle of the conversion chain. Most consumer electronics start with a rectifier these days. And then we come to lighting. And lighting is a very interesting case. Now, the lighting here, as far as I can see, is still quite traditional TL lighting. But in the new buildings that are being equipped these days, you see strings of LED lights. And they're all driven by DC supplies. And they are now getting connected more and more by DC cabling. And there's actually new standardization coming up for lighting systems based upon DC. In a parallel world, the big data centers, the data centers that Google and Facebook and companies like that are building all over the world now, honestly, the latest data centers that were built were all with DC cabling, because it just saves them a lot of these conversion steps that you normally have if you would have done it by AC. A lot of people think you save a lot of losses that way, but honestly, it's just a few percent. You don't have to do it to get a payback on the losses, but it's just simplification, and by that, less investment and higher reliability. That's important for data centers. That is what they want in the end. Now, this technology, it's already in the lighting. It's already in the PV areas. The batteries are almost a mass product. Now, will these? What will we do? Well, we see it happening that pretty soon office buildings will be equipped with more DC cabling than AC cabling. And then bringing it to private dwellings is just a small step. I know a lot of people have allergies if we talk about DC cabling and DC protection. It's just another philosophy, but in the end, it's proven many times that it can be made as safe as the traditional AC systems as well. Yeah, already, yeah.
So finally, the cost of the AC-DC conversion from the grid that you still need,
yeah,
this will be less pricey or cost less?
Yeah, we will have one gateway, an AC-DC bidirectional gateway to the grid, at a certain point.
That's less costly than all the
Well, what is cost? These days is extremely expensive. But for instance, in a data center, it's worth the investment because they get a payback through their enhanced reliability. For instance, data centers these days, they are being built with distributed backup batteries. So it's not a single basement full of batteries and a diesel generator next to it. No, it's distributed. And that saves them a lot of very expensive square meters. They have... I won't go into details, but they can make their cabling much more reliable and denser. So there are lots of advantages that they already have. So for them, it's a total picture. Now, if you would look at, think of that microgrid. Yeah, if you're going to be more autonomous and you go to a higher level of self-support, okay, then a lot of the other interfaces go down in capacity and less price. Yeah.
About safety, so as far as I can remember, I'm not a specialist, but is DC lethal from 48 volt?
Yeah, that's 48 volt, but for the other applications like data applications, IT applications, it's 380 as a standard.
But it means then to get the same power, you have a lot of current more...
If you stick to 48 volt, but 48 volt is for the LED lights. But the trick is LED lights have an enormously high efficiency.
Yes, but for in a common house, to guarantee the same safety as the one is already present, so you will need much more current.
It depends. Let's say there is a zone between 380 and 48 that still needs to be standardized. And that is for these smaller, traditional, the old single phase applications. The cabling there shouldn't be bigger. Let's say the protection is a totally different philosophy. And the cabling, you don't have to work with radial systems, they work with buses. If you want to look at how it could be, if you go to automation, big drive systems, if you have lots of drives working in parallel on a belt, or for instance in a factory, a lot of these drives are already connected with common DC buses. That is more the technology that is that can implement it without excessive cabling and without excessive protection. But protection, why can protection be made simpler than you think? The protection we have these days are fuses. Now, why do fuses blow? If something goes wrong, you have an enormous short circuit current, and you have an enormous short circuit current because we've got that very powerful electricity grid behind the short circuit. So it immediately generates a massive current. But with these, all the currents are limited by the power electronics. If you short circuit a DC array, something in, somewhere in between, you won't see a rise in current. No, you will see a drop in voltage. So you will detect errors by monitoring parameters like voltages rather than looking at fuses that blow up. So it's an active, intelligent kind of protection that you move to. Well, there are. It will take a while before you have to recable your house, but let's say in a decade or so, I predict that there will be, especially bigger buildings, office buildings, be rather equipped with these kind of technologies than with the standard AC technologies. Yeah. Okay, and this comes along with another trend. We are used to having PV power on the roof. Lots of solar cells are on our roofs. The average color of the Belgian roof went from red to blue in just a few years. Now, I think all the good roofs are already covered. So what's the next step? There's still much more to gain. Well, we still have facades, we have complicated roofs, roofs with shadows. And there we see a trend towards more building integrated, towards smaller PV systems with integrated conversion, with micro conversion, and so on. And this would also perfectly fit in that idea of more DC into the PV system. Because in the end, you have systems with small distributed PV units. It can be in a window. These days you can make transparent windows that are a little bit, you can change the transparency, but there are micro stripes of PV cells on them. You can all connect them to a converter that is somewhere in the frame of the window. And then how are you going to connect all of these converters? There are systems on the market that put DC converters in series, others put them in parallel. For the moment, the voltages are not that high yet. But if you go to bigger buildings, we can use again those buses with plus or minus 380 volt, and then you can may reach these high DC voltages for big systems. Of course, it makes logic that on the same bus, you will introduce the storage again. So you see also there, PV, it looked as though if all the PV had gone to China already. Well, with these kind of PV systems, there's maybe a revival of the PV industry in this in Europe. Now, the converters themselves, there's also a lot happening there. Yeah? It may look as if power electronics stopped at the invention of the last power MOSFET. Well, these days we are completely turning around everything in power electronics. Why? There are new types of semiconductors on the market. They are based upon what is called as wide bandgap semiconductors, which is some quantum mechanic indication of something very complicated. It means in practice you get totally new components that switch not at frequencies of several kilohertz, but switch at say frequencies of several megahertz. So this has the capability to shrink all the converters with a factor 10 or maybe more in the end. Because everything becomes smaller. Coils, capacitors, everything will shrink in proportionally to the frequency. But of course, with these new components, everything is not over yet. We need to think of all the EMC problems, drivers, control problems, cooling problems. If you shrink something, it gets harder to cool, and so on. Now, initially, the electromobility was behind these new technologies, but it is rapidly being introduced in, for instance, photovoltaic converters and so on. So these gallium nitride semiconductors, is that interesting for us? Of course, it's an interesting research subject. You have to redesign a whole technology in just a few years. All the design rules, all the books have to be rewritten. But what's also interesting, a lot of those components are made in Belgium. Not many people know that, but in Oudenaarde, that is actually where these components get produced these days. In the former Mitic clean rooms on semiconductor is making them here. So it's hard for some people who are in microelectronics, but there's more power electronic activities these days in this country than microelectronic activities. Now, I can tell you a lot about what could happen and what we could simulate and what we envision and so on, but we should also try it out in practice. And that's where the fun really begins. Because you can always make a lab system and the lab system will of course always work. Yeah. But you have to test these technologies in real houses with real people who really don't understand what they are. So to do that, we need living labs. And that is something that we need to do more in the future. Because a problem with all these technologies is interoperability, is compatibility, and also is acceptance by real users. So we just finished a project, and I want to tell you a little bit about that. I have little time, I'm afraid. Yeah, I'll do a very quick talk about it. A small project where we tested out these technologies in practice. That was the Linear project with Vito, IMEC, KU Leuven, a lot of companies. You can very quickly see their logos here. But the big question we had to solve is, it's very nice that we may make neighborhoods like this, turn them into smart neighborhoods. But the question is, yeah, we know there will be solar cells, we can use storage, but then the loads. There's also lots of flexibility in the loads, lots of controllability. And we wanted to find out in practice, how big is this flexibility? How easily is it usable? And for that, we worked with about 240 families. You see, they lived all over the place. There were some small areas that were equipped more than others. But all of these families got a smart meter, a special smart meter prepared by us. We got all the raw data. Some of these families got smart plugs. Actually, I was test user number 2. I live somewhere here. I got 8 smart plugs. All my big loads were measured all the time. So for the sake of research, I completely gave up my privacy, and all the PhD students in our group could see when I did what thing in my house. And after the project, they absolutely all confirmed that I had a very boring life. So you see privacy, come on. Now, so we tested, we gave some of these family smart appliances. Some of them got a different tariff model to see whether they would respond to that. Others were given for a while an electric vehicle to see how that would impact their consumption and so on. Now, I was personally in the group that got this, and that smart white goods. So it doesn't mean that from now on I would be wearing dirty clothes if the sun was not shining. No, it was just as before. But the way these loads were controlled was a little bit different. I basically had to say, or somebody else in the family had to say, when the dishes needed to be clean. Instead, you just push the start button, you set clean by that period. And then some agent system decided when it was a good time to operate these loads, and everything balanced out on its own. With that, we could determine how much potential there is in flexible loads that you can use for demand side management, that you can use in a portfolio that you can shift during the day, for instance, to balance out errors in prediction of wind power. That was a business case that was studied. We could prove that by smarter controlling certain devices on the grid, that we could bring down that overvoltage problem when you had excessive infeed of photovoltaic electricity. And in the end, if you did that carefully, you could show that we could help the distribution system operators with extending the lifetime of their transformers. These were just business cases that came out of that big field test, the living labs that we conducted. And here you see the partners who conducted it. I'll stop here because my time, I know. And of further questions.
Display about the DC, can you turn that back and then I can ask you? Oh, yeah. Why do you need an energy manager?
Because this is actually the implementation of that demand side management on these.
Actually, you can also let a computer.
But that's basically, this is an abstract system. It can be a centralized controller or a decentralized. There are many ways to implement that. Yeah, absolutely. You can actually, the simplest implementation of that is just watching the voltage and then implement something like a feedback if the voltage goes up and down. That's. Somebody needs to stabilize it, and we don't have like a big generator anymore that will do that for everybody, like in the AC grid. So it needs to be done distributed.
Thank you for your presentation. You talked about a smart interface in order to be able to integrate all these flexible loads or distributed generation units. And then you talked about about it in a centralized mode, also with a distributed controls?
We tried both.
So yeah. I would like to ask you if you have in mind a business model that would incentivize both the DSO and users to apply this in real life and not in the pilot.
If there's a business model, you need to think of who gets the benefits first, exactly. Potentially. You can download the full report of that project on the website here, and there they talk about all the different business models that they tried out. For instance, I was in the test group where I got a payback per kilowatt hour I offered in flexible load. So if I delayed the washing of the dishes for one night, it's more or less 8 kilowatt of flexibility that you can offer that way, and I got a payback on my electricity bill for that.
Yeah, but for the centralized system,
yeah, for the central
DSO or the customers who would have
paid? It depends. The DSO has certain benefits like that line voltage control. That's probably a complicated one because that's managed through reactive power and not active power, and nobody A understands that, B is interested, and C is able to control that in a decent way. But that's a bit more complicated. I think for certain ancillary services, either you put them on the market like Cedric has presented that way, and with an aggregator party in between, who will collect and take over the distributed control in an area, or it will come out of necessity as an obligation to just install it. And that is what we see happening in Germany. If you want to put PV in Germany these days, you're more or less obliged to install batteries or any form of storage to limit the risk of feeding too much back into the grid. So in Germany, there's already a market for these battery systems. There are four big producers already selling it, and you just have to install. Since 2 weeks, also Mercedes sells batteries there. And yes, they don't have blinking lights either. So, I think a fully centralized controlled system is maybe a little bit too complicated. I believe more in a sort of hierarchical system that you work with aggregators, so that aggregators can take part of the risk, the operational risk, also maintain the hardware. There's also a big interoperability problem. Just to equip all those 240 houses, our biggest headache was making all the systems talk to each other. Yeah, we had wireless systems, Zigbee systems, PLC systems, and honestly, if it all worked from day one, that was a coincidence. Nobody believed that in the end, so, yeah.
How did you do it?
Yeah. You don't want to know. Lots of technicians.
Yeah.
Lots of technicians. And you pay learning time. Yeah. Actually, with my washing machines, the PLC interface in my washing machines in my house were replaced 3 times during the course of the project, just to make them work.
Okay. Is there enough effort from the manufacturers of all these house appliances?
Oh, well, there are some who are really into this market. You recognize the brands, but some, let's say, more the high-end machines, they have things that are smart grid ready. And they are, for instance, in Germany already compatible with those systems with batteries. So the moment there is a market, they immediately roll it out. So, but in our country, honestly, for the moment with the current market rules, there's no way you can get a good payback. So I still have those washing machines. The only time I use them in an intelligent way is during a demo. I take the app here and I can show you that I can start my washing machine. That's about it. For the moment, I don't have a financial benefit from it anymore after the project, because we need smart regulation. That's where we are stuck.
When can we have it?
I think the current Flemish energy minister is doing a bit of effort to get it out, but fortunately regulation in this country is a mix of federal and regional levels, and that's where sometimes things are not compatible.
If you could change 2 things, if you could ask any 2 things from a regulator,
what would be for you to find? 2? Oh god.
Make it 3, maybe 3.
I don't know, there's so many things.
See smart meters, having a business case.
Well, I think we need some kind of smart platforms. They're always called smart meters, but metering is one thing and controlling is another thing. We need smart platforms, smart interfaces somehow. And they should be made available. And for the rest, there are several details in the technical code I would like to see change, like things. It's forbidden to inject reactive power, so we cannot control the voltage locally. It's just forbidden. We cannot inject unbalanced current, although it would help the system. And those little technical details, I have a list of that. I would ask to have a look at that too. Okay, thanks.